In this webcast, we're going to look at another reaction of monosaccharides. It's the base-promoted isomerization reaction. And if you take the glucose and expose it to strong base over the period of several days, you'll end up with a mixture of sugars, as you can see here. In the case of D-glucose, you'd find that after several days, about 64% is going to end up being the D-glucose form. There'll be about 2.5% of the C2 epimer. The C2 epimer of D-glucose is mannose, and you'll also end up with about 31% of this ketose, the D-fructose, so where the carbonyl group has migrated into position number 2. What's the mechanism by which this process takes place? Well, as you might guess, it also involves the open chain form. So if we begin with D-glucopyranose, the hemiacetal form shown here, there's the anomeric carbon. It's the only carbon with two oxygens bound to it. It opens up into the aldose. The aldose is just like any other carbonyl. At the alpha position, and that's the key point, at the alpha position, we have an acidic hydrogen that can be deprotonated under strongly basic conditions. And that's exactly the pathway by which this mechanism proceeds. Now that we have the carbanion, it's a resonance stabilized carbanion. That carbanion has an enolate-like form, and so that's always a key form to remember with the deprotonated alpha position. But what happens in forming D-mannose is that we simply reprotonate at that alpha carbon position, the carbanion, but we reprotonate from the opposite side. So it's like any other sp3 carbanion. It can undergo inversion of configuration rapidly, pyramidal inversion like we saw with nitrogen very early on in the semester. So if water serves as the acid to protonate that carbanion, we end up with the C2, we can end up with the C2 epimer D-mannose. From the enolate anion, that's how we're going to get into D-fructose, we're going to end up basically making the C2 and C3 positions equivalent, and the way we'll do that is by protonating that oxygen to make what's known as an enediol. And so this is an important intermediate because now both of these positions, the position C2 as well as the carbon C1, have equivalent states in terms of their oxidation state, and it's easy to interconvert between a carbonyl at position 2 and position 1 simply by adding a proton to the face that, as is shown here, if we use the base to deprotonate the hydroxyl group on C2, we can end up making the carbonyl, and this tautomerization essentially is what it is. This tautomerization reaction can lead to the carbonyl at the position C2, and we have picked up the new proton on the C1, which is now alpha, the alpha position, to the new carbonyl location. And so it's just like any other chemistry of carbonyl compounds. Under strongly basic conditions, we can do a deprotonation at the alpha position that, through tautomerization, can move the position of the carbonyl.